are back for another episode, part two. Immediately with hesitation, pretty much. Took a little break of the Passover. So this is part two, which actually has the Passover story in it. That was kind of like set up to Passover. But no, pal, it's part one of the Passover story. Let's be honest about it. So, really, and we're even going to teach a little bit. You know, this is Sunday school, so at this point, when we get through it, we'll have a couple little verses there. You know, something about the angel of the Lord, and something about Passover, what it might mean to a Christian. But also, we're going to be faithful even what it might mean to the Jews, even absent if, they, you know, Jesus is just a good man or a prophet or whatever. He was Jewish, you got to give him that. He didn't even walk around as fake. Oh, okay. Excuse me, so was King David, according to some of you very Hebrew people. And if he was real, you know he was ruthless. He wasn't, like, nice, like it says in your holy book. Diligently recorded. You know, you can trust those ones. You can trust those. They don't know about idols. Slow down. We are going to read Deuteronomy 9 as well, right? Chosen ones. Because really, I think we all need to remember that. And I think you do. Because it was Abraham. You know, Abraham. Are you Abraham? Am I Abraham? No. Well, you know, Michael Eisner was reincarnated, I think. Or maybe the Christian poker group. One of them at least, or a couple. Ah, okay. Okay, 8th class. Got it. Anyway. Yeah. Don't get me started. I don't hate anyone. But them, I don't know, something about, And is that kitty litter? I think it was kitty litter you were breathing in there, right? No, I don't think it was kitty litter. Oh, that was cleaning products. I don't think it was cleaning products. Something about it. Tale for another time, maybe. Listen, I don't want to get into it. I ain't going to kill it. Oh, you go up there and some, breathe it in. I ain't going. Oh, okay. Anyway, tale for another time. Who can say? I always ask, forgive me my sins as I forgive those who sin against me. Forgive us my debts as I forgive my debtors. I even do it. But, Christian? Christian? Don't talk about Christian. Playoff? Christian? Hey, pal. Take Anna. You're going to come home. You're going to come. This is a court-appointed attorney. Anyway. I don't want to listen. That was not my bit. We left off on the sixth plague. Very short one. I'm going to overlap and read it again, all right? Because as we know, the fifth plague over here. We beat that joke to death, right? Which one's Billy D? Where's Billy D? Where is Action Jack? Where is he? It was Ajax. Where is he? Because in the fifth plague, you know, the livestock were all diseased. You know, the livestock got the pestilence. They all died out. But then any other beast that was around, you know, dogs, cats, whoever. Well, that's the sixth plague. They suffered right along with the men and the women with the boils. So Yahweh said to Moses and Aaron, you know, the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, take for yourselves a handful of ashes from a furnace and let Moses scatter it towards the heavens in the sight of Pharaoh. And it will become fine dust in all the land of Egypt, and it will cause boils that break out in sores on man and beast throughout all the land of Egypt. Then they took ashes from the furnace and stood before Pharaoh, and Moses scattered them toward heaven. Picture that scene. He just looks at them and throws it up. He didn't even warn him about that sixth plague, because the heart of Pharaoh became hard at the end of the fifth. He did not let the people go. So listen, he just stares at him. He throws those ashes up. Then they took the ashes from the furnace, stood before Pharaoh, and Moses scattered them towards heaven. And they caused boils that break out in sores on man and beast. They caused boils that broke out and break out in sores on man and beast. And the magicians, Dumbledore and them, could not stand before Moses because of the boils. For the boils were on the magicians and all the Egyptians, and the Egyptian priests, all people. But Yahweh hardened the heart of the Pharaoh, and he did not heed them, just as the Lord, Yahweh, had spoken to Moses. Then the Lord said to Moses, this is the seventh plague. Excuse me. Then the Lord said to Moses, rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, let my people go, that they may serve me. For at this time I will send all my plagues to your very heart, and on your servant and on your people, that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. Now, if I had stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, then you would have been cut off from the earth. But indeed, for this purpose, I have raised you up, that I may show you my power. That I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. Everyone found out about the Exodus one, because until then they understood the Egypt something about. As yet you exalt yourself against my people, in that you will not let them go. Behold, tomorrow about this time I will cause very heavy hail to rain down, such as has not been in Egypt since its founding until now. They didn't. And therefore, send now and gather your livestock and all that you have in the field. Nothing. For the hail shall come down on every man and every animal which is found in the field and not brought home, and they shall die. Now we already know, the cattle in the field, the horses, the donkeys, the camels, the oxen, the sheep, they're toast. We already know that. That was the fifth plague. So this is more of a jeer anyway. It really verbatim. You don't think he would have understood that? Screw you. But there was some animals. For this very purpose. But all the livestock of Egypt died out. But all them. Something about it. I understand verbatim. I understand Moses wrote this personally. He did not lie. I even understand it. He who feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his livestock flee to the houses. But he who did not regard the word of the Lord left his servants and his livestock in the field. Maybe they replaced ranks a little bit, but I doubt it. Because when, between the, you understand there's like a couple days that go by in between one and the other. It is Egypt. But pal, there weren't very many livestock left. There were no cattle. There were no horses, donkeys, camels, oxen, and sheep, and cattle. There was a severe pestilence. Maybe they bought some from the Hebrews. Who knows? Because the Hebrew livestock was fine. So, in order to have cattle, who knows? He who feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his livestock flee to the houses. But he who did not regard the word of the Lord left his servants and his livestock in the field. Both. Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand towards heaven, that there may be hail in all the land of Egypt. He even warned him. On man, on beast, and on every herb of the field throughout the land of Egypt. And Moses stretched out his rod towards heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail, and fire darted to the ground. And the lore of, this is a fake story, because the Lord, no. And Yahweh and the Lord rained hail on the land of Egypt. So there was hail, and fire mingled with the hail. That's strange. So very heavy that there was none like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation. Who's to say the science of how he did it? He could have just done it. It could have been something to do with a volcano. Sure. Could have been whatever it was. He wouldn't need that. Who knows? And the hail struck throughout the whole land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast. And the hail struck every herb of the field and broke every tree of the field. Only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, there was no hail. Not even a little. And Pharaoh sent and called for Moses and Aaron and said to them, I have sinned this time. Yahweh is righteous, and my people and I are wicked. He even got it. Entreat the Lord, entreat Yahweh, that there may be no more mighty thundering and hail, for it is enough. I will let you go, and you shall stay no longer. Okay. So Moses said to him, as soon as I have gone out of the city, I will spread out my hands to the Lord, to Yahweh. The thunder will cease, and there will be no more hail, that you may know that the earth is Yahweh's. That the earth is the Lord's. But as for you and your servants, I know that you will not yet fear the Lord God. I know that you will not yet fear Yahweh God. Now the flax and the barley were struck, for the barley was in the head and the flax was in the bud. But the wheat and the spelt were not struck, for they are late crops. So Moses went out of the city from Pharaoh and spread out his hand to Yahweh, to the Lord. Then the thunder and the hail ceased, and the rain was not poured on the earth. And when Pharaoh saw that the rain, the hail, and thunder had ceased, he sinned yet more, and he hardened his heart, he and his servants. So the heart of Pharaoh was hard, neither would he let the children of Israel go. As Yahweh had spoken by Moses. As the Lord had spoken by Moses. He even told him, no, it's not going to do it. That's the seventh plague. Time for the eighth plague, because that didn't work. God hardened Pharaoh's heart. He even kind of rigged it. Think about it. He even said, I will harden his heart. God said, I will harden his heart. Anyway, but do you understand what he had done to the people? Anywho, now the Lord said to Moses, go in to Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants, that I may show these signs of mine before him, and that you may tell in the hearing of your son and your son's son the mighty things I have done in Egypt, and my signs which I have done among them, that you may know that I am the Lord, that I am Yahweh, that I am who I am. Savvy? So Moses and Aaron came into Pharaoh and said to him, "Thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? Let my people go, that they may serve me. Or else, if you refuse to let my people go, behold, tomorrow I will bring locusts into your territory. And they shall cover the face of the earth, so that no one will be able to see the earth. And they shall eat the residue of what is left, which remains to you from the hail. And they shall eat every tree which grows up for you out of the field. They shall fill your houses, the houses of all your servants, and the houses of all the Egyptians, which neither your fathers nor your fathers' fathers have seen, since the day that they were on the earth to this day." And he turned and went out from Pharaoh. Then Pharaoh's servants said to him, "How long shall this man be a snare to us? Let the men go, that they may serve the Lord their God, that they may serve Yahweh their God. Do you not yet know that Egypt is destroyed?" So Moses and Aaron were brought again to Pharaoh, and he said to them, "Go, serve the Lord your God. Who are the ones that are going?" Moses said, "We will go with our young and our old, with our sons and our daughters, with our flocks and our herds we will go, for we must hold a feast to the Lord." We must hold a feast to Yahweh. Then he said to them, "The Lord had better be with you when I let you and your little ones go. Beware, for evil is ahead of you. Not so. Go now, you who are men, and serve the Lord, for that is what you desired." And they were driven out from Pharaoh's presence. So he even said, "You can go," but he just had to. Right? He said he could go. But he said, "The Lord had better be with you when I let you and your little ones go. Beware, for evil is ahead of you." It's a veiled threat, not even. "Not so. Go now, you who are men, and serve the Lord, for that's what you desire." And they were driven out from Pharaoh's presence. So, then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the land of Egypt for the locusts, that they may come up upon the land of Egypt and eat every herb of the land, all that the hail has left." Just for that. He even said he could go. So Moses stretched out his rod over the land of Egypt, and the Lord brought an east wind on the land all that day and all that night. When it was morning, the east wind brought the locusts. And the locusts went up over all the land of Egypt and rested on all the territory of Egypt. They were very severe. Previously, there had been no such locusts as they, nor shall there be such after them. For they covered the face of the whole earth so that the land was darkened. There was no ground left. When he says the whole earth, he means like the earth, the actual ground. You couldn't even see it. The land was darkened, and they ate every herb of the land and all the fruit of the trees which the hail had left. So there remained nothing green on the trees or on the plants of the field throughout all the land of Egypt. All the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron in haste and said, "I have sinned against Yahweh, your God, and against you. Now therefore, please forgive my sin only this once, and entreat the Lord your God, and entreat Yahweh your God, that he may take away from me this death only." So he went out from Pharaoh and entreated the Lord, and the Lord turned a very strong west wind, which took the locusts away and blew them into the Red Sea. There remained not one locust in all the territory of Egypt. Not one. But Yahweh, but the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart. And he did not let the children of Israel go, even after the ninth plague. That was the eighth plague, excuse me. That was still two more. Savvy? Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand towards heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, darkness which may even be felt. This is a strange darkness. So Moses stretched out his hand toward heaven, and there was thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. They did not see one another, nor did anyone rise from his place for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light in their dwellings. Then Pharaoh called to Moses and said, go serve the Lord. Only let your flocks and your herds be kept back. Let your little ones go also with you. But, you know, we kind of need those flocks. But Moses said, you must also give us sacrifices and burnt offerings that we may sacrifice to the Lord our God. Our livestock also shall go with us. Not a hoof shall be left behind. Not one hoof. For we must take some of them to serve the Lord our God, and even we do not know with what we must serve the Lord until we arrive there. Well, he had even told him that was bland. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart. He really needed those livestock for a win, you know. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let them go. Then Pharaoh said to Moses, get away from me. Take heed to yourself and see my face no more. For in the day you see my face, you shall die. So Moses said, you have spoken well. I will never see your face again. Chapter 11. And the Lord said to Moses, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and Egypt. On Pharaoh and on Egypt. Afterward, he will let you go from here. When he lets you go, he will surely drive you out of here altogether. He will just let you go. Speak now in the hearing of the people, and that every man ask from his neighbor and every woman from her neighbor articles of silver and articles of gold. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, because, duh, they get it. That just happened. All those things. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt in the sight of Pharaoh's servants and in the sight of the people. Then Moses said, thus says the Lord, about midnight I will go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh, who sits on his throne, even in the firstborn of the female servant who is behind the handmill, and all the firstborn of the animals, both. Then there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as was not like it before, nor shall there be again. But against none of the children of Israel shall a dog move its tongue. Against man or beast, that you may know that the Lord does make a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. And all these your servants shall come down to me, and bow down to me, saying, and all these your servants shall come down to me and bow down to me, saying, get out, and all the people who follow you. After that, I will go out. Because that's Moses. Moses is talking to Pharaoh. He even tells him. Because think of it, the death of the firstborn announced. I want to make sure, because I almost capitalized the me, but no, I think he, then he went, but he couldn't be Pharaoh. I'll never see her face again. So maybe they just didn't capitalize. I'm going to read it again. This Vex, we've got to get to the Chip and Dale here. We're going to figure this out here. death of the firstborn else. And the Lord said to Moses, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt. Afterwards, he will let you go from here. When he lets you go, he will surely drive you out of here altogether. Speak now in the hearing of the people. Ah, that's why it was his own people. Then Moses said, thus says the Lord, about midnight I will go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh who sits on his throne, even to the firstborn of the female servant who is behind the handmill, and all the firstborn of the animals. Then there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as was not like it before, nor shall it be like it again. But against none of the children of Israel shall a dog move its tongue, against man or beast, that you may know that the Lord does make a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. Then there's a little unquote. Got it. But Moses is still talking. And all these your servants shall come down to me. Your servants shall come down to me and bow down to me, saying, get out. And all the people who follow you. After that, I'll go out. Then he went out from Pharaoh in great anger. So maybe he was talking to Pharaoh. How about that? But the Lord, because maybe it was continuous, because there's no chapter 11 here. Maybe he said, you have spoken well, I'll never see your face again. And the Lord said to Moses, I will bring one more. I don't know. Whatever it is, it's correct. I'm going to read that again, because it vexes me. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let them go. Then Pharaoh said to him, get away from me. Take heed to yourself and see my face no more. For in the day you see my face, you shall die. So Moses said, you have spoken well. You've spoken well. I'll never see your face again. And the Lord said to Moses, I'll bring one more plague on the Pharaoh and on Egypt. Afterwards, he will let you go from here. When he lets you go, he will surely drive you out of here altogether. Speak now in the hearing of the people, and let every man ask from his neighbor, and every woman from her neighbor, articles of silver and articles of gold. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's servants, and in the sight of the people. Then Moses said, thus says the Lord. Was it an assembly? Who went out from Pharaoh in great anger? I think when he says, you have spoken well, I will never see your face again. Right? I think it was more of a innuendo. Because he didn't let him go. Because clearly he sees his face again. Like the next day. It's very clear. Then he went out from Pharaoh in great anger. But the Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh will not heed you, so that my wonders may be multiplied in the land of Egypt. So when he says, you've spoken well, I'll never see your face again, he does in fact see his face again. It's just Moses saying, you've spoken well, I will never see your face again, right? He's just verbatim telling you what happened. Bit by bit. He does see his face again. He's not scared of him. Pharaoh is terrified of this man. He's overcompensated. But it does bug me sometimes. Like, wait a minute. I even try to pick it apart. I cannot. You understand it? No, really. And Yahweh said to Moses, I'm going to bring death of the firstborn an ounce. It's not complex. I've read it before, but then I read it, and I'm into it. Moses said, you've spoken well. I will never see your face again. It was like a diss pack. And the Lord said to Moses, I'll bring one more plague on Pharaoh. No, I'm going to bring one more. And on Egypt. Afterwards, he'll let you go from here. When he lets you go, he will surely drive you out of here altogether. This is the beginning of Passover, this is the story of Passover, so we're getting it right. Speak now in the hearing of the people, and let every man ask from his neighbor and every woman from her neighbor articles of silver and articles of gold. And the Lord and Yahweh gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's servants and in the sight of the people. The people speak to the people. Of the people speak to the Egyptians. Then Moses said, thus says the Lord to the Egyptians, about midnight I will go out into the land, about midnight I will go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh, who sits on his throne, even in the firstborn of the female servant, who is behind the handmill, and all the firstborn of the animals, just all of them. Then there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as was not like it before, nor shall be like it again. But against none of the children of Israel shall a dog move its tongue, against man or beast, that you may know that the Lord does make a difference. The Lord does make a difference. Because remember, some of those animals just got boils. Even they got the boils. That you may know that the Lord does make a difference. Wait a minute. That you may know that the Lord does make a difference between the Egyptians and Israel. And all these your servants shall come down to me and bow down to me, saying, get out, and all the people who follow you. After that, I'll let you go. Then he went out from Pharaoh in great anger. But the Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh will not heed you, so that my wonders may be multiplied in the land of Egypt. So Moses and Aaron did all these wonders before Pharaoh. And the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he did not let the children of Israel go out of his land. Let's recap it. This is how it's written. Now we go to 12. This is the Passover instituted. This is Passover. This is what they celebrate. Passover. Something with the lamb and blood as well. Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbors next to his house take it according to the number of the persons. According to each man's need, you shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire, with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs. They shall eat it. Do not eat it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire. Its head with its legs and its entrails. You shall let none of it remain until morning. And what remains of it until morning you shall burn with fire. And thus you shall eat it. With a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. It is Yahweh's Passover. That's how he told Moses to eat it. And that's how he told the people to eat it. That particular Passover, they had to eat it in haste. And you understand, there is a festival of unleavened bread later, but this is the actual Passover too. Then he says, for I will pass through the land of Egypt. For I, God Almighty, will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. Uh-oh. I am the Lord. They did not leave the demon out. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Basically, you better do it or I'm not going to pass over you. And the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. They didn't actually tell the Egyptians to paint blood. Not once. So this day shall be to you a memorial. And you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it as a feast by an everlasting ordinance. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall remove the leaven from your houses. For whoever eats leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from Israel. Now remember, this is the Old Testament. You better understand, like, some of us understand, like, he'll forgive you if in these days, but really. But wait a minute. If you do the, depends on how good you just understand, it vexes the Almighty. He's quite clear here. You would need grace and forgiveness to, Well, there is an angel of the Lord, you know, he's also Messiah, he's also the Lamb of God. We do have a Lamb of God, but that's like the Son of God, you know. It's not necessarily the ding ting tong with the ping a tong and the 21st century emotion. I bet it's not. But listen, I'm just reading the Passover story here. And I'm just saying, literally just verbatim. For whoever eats leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from the land of Israel. On the first day, there shall be a holy convocation. And on the seventh day, there shall be a holy convocation for you. No manner of work shall be done on them, but that which everyone must eat, that only may be prepared by you. So you shall observe the Feast of Unleavened Bread, for on this same day I will have brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore, you shall observe this day throughout your generations as an everlasting ordinance. In the first month, on the 14th day of the month, at evening, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. For 7 days, no leaven shall be found in your houses. Since whoever eats what is leavened, that same person shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he is a stranger or a native of the land. You shall eat nothing leavened. In all your dwellings, you shall eat unleavened bread. Okay. Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said to them, pick out and take lambs for yourselves according to your families, and kill the Passover lamb. And you shall take a bunch of hyssop, dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning. For the Lord, for Yahweh, will pass through to strike the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and not allow the destroyer to come into your houses to strike you. Now, who's the destroyer if not the angel of the Lord? Or Yahweh. Either way, he's going to pass over and he's going to bring his little friend there with him. The destroyer? Who knows? That's just what it says. And you shall observe this thing as an ordinance for you. I'm going to read that part. No, really, that's in Exodus. He explains something about the angel of God. He sure does. He makes it clear. And you shall observe this thing as an ordinance for you and your sons forever. It will come to pass when you come to the land which the Lord will give you, just as he promised, that you shall keep this service. And it shall be when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? That you shall say, it is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord. Who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians and delivered our households. So the people bowed their heads and worshipped. Then the children of Israel went away and did so, just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. So they did. Okay? And you understand something about even how Solomon dedicates the temple. When we sin, when we screw it up, they even law. You understand, he does forgive. He even has to say later, I will. But something was really important. And it shall be, when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service, that you shall say, it is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt, when he struck the Egyptians and delivered our household. So next is the 10th plague, the death of the firstborn. So we'll get into that in a little bit. I don't care if this one's an hour and a half. I don't care, pal. All righty. Back in a flash. Pookity cloosh. So, well, we're at the Passover. So you understand it. They did the unleavened bread. Then Moses called for all the elders and said to them, pick out the lambs for yourselves according to your family. Kill the Passover lamb. Yada, yada, yada. And so the people bowed their heads and worshiped. Then the children of Israel went away and did so, just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. So they did. And they painted the blood of the lamb on their doors. And it came to pass at midnight that the Lord struck all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of the livestock that remained. Not very many. So Pharaoh rose in the night, he, all his servants, and all the Egyptians, just all of Egypt. And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. Then he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, you know, Pharaoh did see him again a couple times, actually. I mean, I'm stupid, but I've read it before. Moses was wrong. He saw his face again, all right. Then he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise, go out from among my people, both you and the children of Israel, and go, serve the Lord as you have said. Also take your flocks and your herds as you have said, and be gone, and bless me also. Let me read it again. Then Pharaoh, then he called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise and go out from among my people, both you and the children of Israel. Go, serve the Lord, as you have said. Also take your flocks and your herds, as you have said, and be gone, and bless me also. Either way, pal. And the Egyptians urged the people. We can do goofy voices. I do. No, I know. And the Egyptians urged the people that they might send them out of the land in haste. For they said, we shall all be dead. The Egyptians urged the people that they might send them out of the land in haste. For they said, we shall all be dead. So the people took their dough before it was leavened, having their kneading bowls bound up in their clothes on their shoulders. Now the children of Israel had done according to the word of Moses, and they had asked from the Egyptians articles of silver, articles of gold, and clothing. And Yahweh and the Lord had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so that they granted them what they requested. No problem. Take it. Thus they plundered the Egyptians. Where do you think they get the gold to make the ark and all that stuff? They plundered the Egyptians. Then the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 men on foot, besides children. The reference to Ramses most likely relates to the store city Ramses mentioned in 1-1, perhaps Tel Daba in the eastern delta region. Succoth is possibly Tel Maskusta, further to the east. Maskuta, further to the east. Huh? I like the study Bible, but also, it's right there. Ramses to Succoth. You know, Ramses, you've heard of the town, the city of Ramses. Didn't they move it at one point? Didn't it become the one that the Ark of the Covenant was buried in Raiders? Because they had to, like, move it or something? I don't know. Could be. I don't know. I don't care. These people would know better than me. But you even have ancient Egypt. You know it's real. You've got the ruins. It's a crazy place. I'd like to visit it one day. I think it'd be cool. Then the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 men on foot, besides children. A mixed multitude went up with them in flocks and herds, a great deal of livestock. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they had brought out of Egypt, for it was not leavened, because they were driven out of Egypt and could not wait, nor had they prepared provisions for themselves. Now, the sojourn of the children of Israel who lived in Egypt was 430 years. And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, on that very same day, it came to pass that all the armies of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. It is a night of solemn observance to the Lord for bringing them out of the land of Egypt. This is the night of the Lord, a solemn observance for all the children of Israel throughout their generations. Then it gets into the ordinances. The Lord said to Moses, "This is the ordinance of the Passover. No foreigner shall eat it. But every man's servant who is bought for money, when you have circumcised him, then he may eat it." It's the Old Testament stuff, pal. Even for a Christian, you better respect the Passover. There's cool stuff here. You know, the number 600,000 men indicates a total population of some 3 million. The actual number of people did not take place until later. You know, this verse should not be regarded as independent witness to the number of fighting men in Israel, the number of the Exodus, since it is derived from the later census. See Numbers 1:46. But who knows? See, that's why it's not the Holy Bible. But you understand, it's a rough, I mean, you know, it even says, if you're focused on that, I'm not saying they are. This is a study Bible, but that ain't it. It's for scholars, it's for whatever. But it's a history book. I understand, for me, I take it verbatim. It's why? Because it doesn't fight, like, logic and reason once, if you're a theist. Particularly, Krish, probably, I don't know. Something. Even the Tao, I like. Oh, yeah, good. Stuff like that. At least I'm not, reek in the eyes of the Almighty. I'm not liable. So that's the Passover story. Now, I was going to get into the Exodus story, right? Which is the very next thing, because now they're on their way. Pharaoh let them go. That's the story of Pharaoh letting God's people go. Let my people go. And leave them kids alone. And let those kids be free. Excuse me, let my kids go. They're not trying to get anywhere. They have the land and the rights. You just won't let them do it. No, oh, even Americans, you're not going to do it. But the idol, you know, oh, okay. Maybe Isaiah, maybe some of them. And the linear story of bookie revelation, and we know how to get out of here. Linear, oh, okay. People, this is useless. Linear, use it. makes any sense is we have to put that one, but all the stuff with the do not withhold good. No, we don't like that verbatim. It doesn't. Book Revelation supersedes, the secret dark deeds. Okay, clip. So that's the story of Passover. That's part two, right? And I did say, and we'll get into the Exodus, the rest of it, because wait a minute, I thought Moses was going to part the Red Sea. That is not part of the Passover story. That's part of the Exodus story. The book is called Exodus. Part one of it is like the Passover story. Actually, part one of it is like Moses like getting called to action by God with the burning bush and the angel of the Lord there. There's something about the angel of the Lord. It is coming up, the Red Sea crossing. I could just read it, but I'm not gonna. I don't want to. But make no mistake, I'll get into it a little bit. Basically, the Pharaoh, I don't know. I don't want to ruin it because I'll do it tomorrow or something. But there is this angel Lord. He does show up, and so does God. And I will skip ahead till I think it's like 33 or 23 or something like that. It's not 32. I don't know. 32 something with this cow. I don't know. Let me find it here. The angel and the promises. God says at some point later, after they're after the open, where he parts the Red Sea, and they, that one's not just from a movie. That's the only one from the Bible. He says, God says, "Behold, I send an angel before you to keep you in the way and to bring you into the place which I have prepared. Beware of him, and obey his voice." Do not provoke him, for he will not pardon your transgressions. Implying that this angel has the power to pardon transgressions. For my name is in him, and indeed Yahweh, and Yahweh our righteous, Yahweh our righteousness, excuse me. Well, Yahweh our righteousness is the Messiah, is Jesus verbatim. Read your Jeremiah 23, pal. It's also Emmanuel. It's also Jesus Christ. That ain't it. Jesus of Nazareth. But again, that's my name is in him. But if you indeed obey his voice and do all that I speak, then I will be an enemy to your enemies and an adversary to your adversaries. For my angel will go before you and bring you to the Amorites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Canaanites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, and I will cut them off. You shall not bow down to their gods, nor serve them, nor do according to their works, but you shall utterly overthrow them and completely break down their sacred pillars. So you shall serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your water. And I will take sickness away from the midst of you. No one shall suffer miscarriage or be barren in your land. I will fulfill the number of your days. But he ends that little spiel there with, for if you serve their gods, it will surely be a snare to you. And indeed, just a couple days later, something about, golden calf. And God wanted to eradicate them off the face of the earth and start over with Moses. Not really. That's part three. You better remember it. That's part of your story. Not all glory here. Glory, you say. Glory. Also, the angel of the Lord was the other one. God was in the front, and the angel of the Lord was in the back. They even kind of knew the guy. And even in Corinthians, Paul seems to say, "Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud. All passed through the sea. All were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. All ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock was the Christ. And indeed, the angel of the Lord followed them from the back in the Exodus story." They're beta. It's almost like, but with most of them, God was not well pleased, for their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Yeah, well, rot. It's almost like, and then he goes right into the idol thing. It's almost like Paul figgied it. And I said I would end with Deuteronomy 9, so I shall. Pretty sure it's Deuteronomy 9. Let's see, Leviticus. It's just something to understand about it. We're all individual. It's not really to sneer, but pal, you understand, I better read it. We'll start with Israel's rebellions reviewed. This is Moses talking. Hear, O Israel, you are to cross over to the Jordan today and go in to dispossess nations greater and mightier than yourself, cities great and fortified up to heaven, a people great and tall, the descendants of the Anakim, whom you know and of whom you heard it said, who can stand before the descendants of Anak or Anakim or whatever they're called. Therefore, understand today that the Lord, your God, is he who goes over before you as a consuming fire. He will destroy them and bring them down before you, so you shall drive them out and destroy them quickly, as the Lord has said to you. Then he says, do not think in your heart, after the Lord your God has cast them out before you, saying, because of my righteousness the Lord has brought me in to possess the land, in to possess this land, you know, Canaan, you know, Israel. But it is because of the wickedness of these nations that the Lord is driving them out before you. It is not because of your righteousness or the uprightness of your heart that you go in to possess their land, but because of the wickedness of these nations that the Lord your God drives them out from before you, and that he may fulfill the word which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Therefore, understand that the Lord your God is not giving you this good land to possess because of your righteousness, for you are a stiff-necked people. Stiff-necked. Remember, do not forget how you provoked the Lord your God to wrath in the wilderness. From the day that you departed from the land of Egypt until you came to this place, you have been rebellious against the Lord. Also in Horeb you provoked the Lord to wrath, so that the Lord was angry enough with you to have destroyed you. When I went up into the mountains to receive the tablet of stone, you know, that God personally wrote, the tablets of the covenant which the Lord made with you, then I stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. I neither ate bread nor drank water. Then the Lord delivered to me two tablets of stone written with the finger of God, and on them were all the words which the Lord had spoken to you on the mountain from the midst of the fire in the day of the assembly. And it came to pass at the end of the 40 days and 40 nights that the Lord gave me the two tablets of stone, the tablets of the covenant. Then the Lord said to me, arise, go down quickly from here, for your people whom you brought out of Egypt have acted corruptly. They have quickly turned aside from the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded image. Furthermore, the Lord spoke to me, saying, I have seen this people, and indeed they are stiff-necked people. Let me alone, that I may destroy them and blot out their name from under heaven, and I will make you a nation mightier and greater than they. So I turned and came down from the mountain, and the mountain burned with fire, and the two tablets of the covenant were in my two hands. And I looked, and behold, you had sinned against the Lord your God. You'd made for yourselves a molded calf. You turned aside quickly from the way which the Lord had commanded you. Then I took the two tablets and threw them out of my hands and broke them before your eyes. And I fell down before the Lord, as at the first, 40 days and 40 nights. I neither ate bread nor drank water because of all your sin, which you committed in doing wickedly in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. For I was afraid of the anger and hot displeasure with which the Lord was angry with you to destroy you. But Yahweh listened to me, but the Lord listened to me at that time also. And the Lord was very angry with Aaron and would have destroyed him. So I prayed for Aaron also at the same time. Then I took your sin, the calf which you had made, and burned it with fire, and crushed it, and ground it very small until it was fine as dust. And I threw its dust into the brook that descended from the mountain. Also at Tabereth, and Massah, and Kibroth, Hattaphah, and you provoked the Lord to wrath. Likewise, when the Lord sent you from Kadesh Barnea or something, Barnea, saying, go up and possess the land which I have given you, then you rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God. You did not believe him nor obey his voice. These are the exact same people. You have been rebellious against the Lord from the day that I knew you. Thus I prostrated myself before the Lord. 40 days and 40 nights I kept prostrating myself because the Lord had said he would destroy you. Therefore I prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord God, do not destroy your people and your inheritance, whom you have redeemed through your greatness, whom you have brought out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Remember your servants Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Do not look on the stubbornness of this people, or on their wickedness or their sin, lest the land from which you brought us should say, because the Lord was not able to bring them to the land which he promised them, and because he hated them, he has brought them out to kill them in the wilderness. Yet they are your people and your inheritance, whom you brought out by your mighty power and your outstretched arm. At that time, the Lord said to me, hew for yourself 2 tablets of stone like the first. Come up to me on the mountain, make yourself an ark of wood. And I will write on the tablets the words that were on the first tablet, which you broke, and you shall put them in the ark. Oy vey. Therefore, circumcise the foreskin of your heart and be stiff-necked no longer. The tabernacle of your heart, you can't trick it or whatever with the, we do the ceremony with the bow. Was the Sabbath made for man or was man made for the Sabbath? Anyway, whatever it is. You see, you get what I'm saying, right? I'm not trying to be a Debbie Downer here. I'm just trying to say you actually have to have love in your heart. Nobody's perfect. Everybody understands. Cast the first stone if you're without sin. Oh, you're not without sin, right? I don't care if you are a Christian. You're not perfect, pal. I don't care if you're Jewish. I don't even care if you're Muslim or atheist. Pal, you ain't perfect once. That ain't it. But in terms of stiff-necked and idols and, cows, and they might be a little stiff-necked. Who knows? But the chosen one, pal, you understand, this is the 21st century. There are plenty of prophets from your very prophets that say, no, they do this. I'll eradicate Israel. They'll cease to exist. And it'll just be a lesson to everyone else on earth who already knows about them that, they just, God got him in the end. No more Israel. He could do it the easy way. Maybe just rename it Judah. I don't know. But you could do it the hard way. I understand something about, the Isaiah one. I didn't want to read it. But he's faithful to people who are faithful. And that ain't it. No, really. So I'm not going to do the Exodus story with the parting. There's lots of other miracles. There's lots of stuff. You have no idea. Nobody reads that part. But this is just the Passover story in full. Part 1 and part 2. God bless you. And I didn't mean to be. That's not a Debbie Downer. Hey, wait a minute. Excuse me. No. Why do you keep that Passover? What's the point of it? Well, right. It's right there. I'll even read that last. I like that line best. Give me a second here. Should be right here. So it shall be when your son asks you in time to come, saying, what is this, that you shall say to him? By strength of the hand of the Lord brought us out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Let me read it proper, because I'm not that mean. So it shall be when your son asks you in time to come, saying, what is this that you shall say to him? By strength of the hand of the Lord brought us out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. And that's not even it. That's reiterating. And it shall be, how about that? And it shall be when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? That you shall say, it is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt, when he struck the Egyptians and delivered our household. Because they don't even try to brag too much. Oh, yeah, 185. Came to pass at midnight, and the Lord struck all the firstborn. Pal, they're all... there was not a house where there was not one dead, verbatim. That's the Mideast one. Even the Christians and the Muslims understand that story. And we know Moses. We all know that one. We can be stiff-necked too. Well, you should not be stiff-necked. Willing to yield. Love, peace, stuff like that. The Lord is peace. God is love. What kind of mother bear would not protect her cubs? That's not love. So you understand, you can provoke. He's also, you know, wrath and all that. But that's why. Anywho. God bless you and happy Passover, really. And to the rest of us, I don't know, Festivus or whatever. Hey, Easter's coming up. Hey, wait a minute. This is, what is that week? Hey, wait a minute. Even us, we understand something about the Lamb of God and his sacrifice. Hey, wait a minute. But, yeah, well, right. Some correlation, maybe. If you're a Christian, you understand correlation. Anyway, God bless you all. Whatever you do or don't believe, really. Passover part two. Ding. Next episode, probably, well, pal, it could be the Exodus one. It very well probably is. And even after that, you understand, there's going to creep in at some point an Easter one. Because, well, duh.